Yeah, this redefines the grilled cheese sandwich. This one's a breakfast grilled cheese, a huevos rancheros with some chorizo. This one's an Italian grilled cheese that has a garlic toast on the outside with Italian cheeses and prosciutto inside. Yummy. Here's your southwestern version. It's got pepper jack and jalapenos. And over here, another breakfast. That is a beautiful egg. You see that yolk is running everywhere with the cheese, the American cheese that's melted. And inside of that, there's some breakfast links. Absolutely delicious. So guys, here you go. That redefines grilled cheese sandwich. Hey guys, welcome back to Texas Cooking Today. On this episode, we're making grilled cheese sandwiches. Oh man, these things are so tasty. Now you might be thinking, but chef, what is there to know? Some American cheese, two pieces of bread, a little bit of butter, slam it down on a grill, cook it up, boom, grilled cheese sandwich. Not too hard. No. We're not going to approach this that way. We're going to look at this a whole different way. We're going to examine the breads. We're going to examine the spreads we put on the bread to be toasted. We're going to look at this in a whole new way. And I'm going to create for you four very special grilled cheese sandwiches. So A, you're going to learn a lot about grilled cheese sandwiches here, and you're going to get four great recipes. But the real reason I wanted to do this show, the important reason I wanted to do this show, was for my younger viewers and for those that are really interested in growing their cooking knowledge and skills. What I'm wanting to do here is to teach one of the most important parts of cooking if you want to be really, really, really good at this. And that is teaching you that creative flow. What ingredients work well together and how to bring them away into together in a way that's unique and new and special and out of the ordinary, but explosive and wonderful. That's what the show is about. It's about growing that creative spurt. So you get four great recipes plus something very special. So I'll tell you what, you guys come over this way. Let's look at these mind-blowing ingredients we have here. Look at all this. And let's make four unbelievably good sandwiches. Come on over. Let's start with our ingredients. And I want to start with the basics. The bread, this stuff here. You can use whatever kind of bread you want, guys. Any kind of bread will work fine. I chose this because it's a thick sliced bread. And I wanted a thick sliced white bread to do this with because I thought it would be showy with some of these ingredients. But at the same time, if you want to use a wheat bread, a rye bread, a multigrain bread, sourdough bread, you can use a ciabatta. That works good also. All these different options in bread just opens up what you can do when it comes to making fantastic grilled cheese sandwiches. Now, what we have here are other ingredients, the basics. Let me move this back. Our spread. Now, there are three basic spreads that are commonly used for making grilled cheese sandwich. One is butter. The second one, which is the vegetable version of butter, margarine, some people call it oleo, that can be used also. Personally, I don't think it's as tasty. I don't like the flavor of it as much. And then there's a third item, and that's mayonnaise. You can use mayonnaise instead of butter. And folks, unless you are a really discerning palate or a trained chef, you're probably not going to be able to tell the difference between a piece of toast that was toasted with butter and a piece of toast that was toasted with mayonnaise. And I tell you what, you might be thinking, oh my God, mayonnaise tastes so much different. It has to taste different. Believe it or not, folks, once they're toasted, it's very, very similar. Only the discerning palate can pick out the slightly higher acid that's in the toast that was made with mayonnaise, okay? And most people can't tell the difference between them at all. So it's a common item to use. Now, I like butter. It's my favorite, and that's what I'm going to use. And we're going to use it in a couple of different ways, and I'm going to show you that in a bit. This is some Parmesan cheese. That is going to be a special ingredient. I'll show you how we use that in a bit. Our cheeses, for this show, we've picked out four different cheeses. I've got some American cheese. I have pepper jack cheese. This is mozzarella cheese and provolone cheese. And I'm going to be doing various sandwiches. One of them is going to be kind of Italian in nature. One of them is going to have provolone and mozzarella with a garlic butter on the outside of the bread. Oh man, and we're putting prosciutto in there. Yummy. We're going to be doing a huevos ranchero scrambled on a grilled cheese. Also, we're going to be making a chilies with pepper jack and a sausage, egg, and grilled American cheese sandwich. Oh, yummy. Now down here, we're not using all of these ingredients, but I wanted to break out plenty of items to really kind of spur your imagination. On our vegetables, let's look at these first. I've got some sweet peppers here. Red, orange, yellow sweet peppers. I also have a jalapeno. Yummy. I have some garlic here. Avocado, onions, shallots. You can use celery. Anything that's not too wet can be used inside of that sandwich. Now, if you put tomato in there, that's probably going to be too wet, guys. It's probably going to leak everywhere. It may not work out too well for you. But a drier ingredient like what you see here should work very, very well. Ingredients that hold their moisture well are what's needed, like onions and avocado. These peppers do very well also. So, our meats, I have picked out a couple of items here that we're going to use and one that we're not. We're going to be putting these sausages in our fried egg sandwich. So that's going to be a fried egg with sausages and cheese. Oh, goodness me. A beautiful breakfast. Now, guys, this one right here, this is called chorizo. This is a Mexican sausage. It's very heavily spiced. It has a lot of fat in it, and it imparts a very distinct and robust flavor to anything that it's added to. I'm going to be using that with the scrambled eggs. The prosciutto right over here, that's for our Italian version of a grilled cheese sandwich. Over here, I broke this out not because I'm going to put it in a sandwich, but I just wanted to spur your thinking. This is some hard salami. You can use pepperoni. You can do all kinds of stuff. Think about this. How about a pepperoni pizza grilled cheese sandwich? That would be pepperoni with a little bit of the marinara on the inside of the bread and maybe some mozzarella cheese, and you melt that all together with that pepperoni, and boom, what do you have? You have a grilled cheese sandwich that tastes like a pepperoni pizza. It's about being creative, and that's the whole idea of all of this, is to help spur the way you think about a very, very basic dish. Now, I tell you what, guys, let's get on with cooking these goodies up. We've got some yummy sandwiches to make. Mmm. All right, guys, let's go ahead and get into cutting up our veggies. Now, whenever we cook on Texas Cooking Today, we do what's called the setup method. And that's where we get everything ready to go before the cooking begins. Then, once everything is ready, we can start cooking, and there is no hesitation or having to wait to do something in order to complete the meal. Now, we didn't invent this. This is the setup method. The French invented this, and it works like a charm. Now, as you saw, I removed the paper from that simply by twisting gently, not hard enough to break the core on this, but it loosens that paper and it just comes right off. You don't have to do any special methods to work out your garlic like this. Now, when it comes to preparing garlic for what we're going to be using it for, I'm going to use this garlic to make a garlic butter. And that garlic butter is going to go down into, or it's going to be used rather, on the bread that we are going to be toasting in our Italian sandwich. Let me show you the technique I'm using here. This is a mincing technique, and it really, really works well. So if you don't have any way of working garlic, if you've got a knife that's offset from the handle like this and sort of not too long the way this one is, that one's too long. If you have a knife that's like this, it works great. And the idea, you're gonna rock the knife up and down just like this to cut through whatever it is that you're working with. Normally I teach my students to choke up on that knife, and you can do that as well. But I find if you want to get good control and speed, you need to do it this way. Number one, bring your hand back on that handle, just like I have it here, and put these fingers on this part of the knife back here, on the back of the knife. You have to keep the thumb tucked under, fully tucked. And what this does is this acts like a control this way, and it provides pressure while this hand provides motion. Easy enough, guys, so let's do this. I will sometimes do this too fast for my camera, and so if it blurs a little bit, I apologize. My focus on my camera really freaks out when my hand's moving that fast because it thinks it's out of focus and it doesn't realize it's not. This is not hard to learn. Once you practice it a little bit, you'll get it. Now you notice how I'm pushing things off of my blade. I'm pushing away from that edge. You don't even have to do that. To wipe off that edge, all you have to do is this and this. You see? So we have a very nice fine mince, and this is going to work real well. Now, by the way, so you'll know, that Parmesan cheese, we're going to add it to this, all right? So those two things go together. There's my Parmesan. There's my garlic. And all I have to do is work in some butter. The next thing that we need to do is to process this jalapeno. Now, when you're wanting to cut up a jalapeno, but you don't want to get all of the heat that's involved in this thing, then here's how you do this. Simply open it up, just like so. Take your paring knife, very gently, run it behind that spine, along where the dark meat begins. Okay, right here, this is 90% of the heat, right there, in a jalapeno. So, from that half, I've removed 90% of the heat. The majority of the heat in a jalapeno is contained within the membrane that connects those seeds to this little light-colored spine. So the more of that you remove, the more heat you've taken out. How's that for simple? All right, that's ready to go. I'm gonna do this half also. Simple. Isn't that easy? Don't make this too difficult, guys. Don't overwork it. Some people are going to say, oh, go ahead and leave the seeds in. Hey, if you want to, that's cool. You can leave them in. It's your choice, but at least now I've shown you how to remove that heat. Now, if you're wondering and you're thinking, hold it, I've had pickled jalapenos before, and those suckers are hot, green part and all. Well, there's a reason for it. During that pickling process, the capsaicin that's in that little membrane that attaches the seed to the interior of the chili, that washes off of that membrane and out into the meat of the chili, which is the green part. Well, if they're not pickled, you don't have that problem. Now, so you'll know the little technique that I'm using here. I want you to learn this. Look how I'm holding my knife. You see how I pinch it right up here in front of my handle, like this? I'm choking up on it. What that does is it gives me control so the knife doesn't spin. If you hold it back here, that knife can twist in your hand real easily. But if you pinch that blade, it cannot. You're under control of that knife at that point. This hand, don't keep those fingers out. You can cut them. Turn those fingertips under just like that, keeping this part of the knuckle right here straight up and down. Just like if you were holding a ball, okay? Look at that. Same position. Boom. All right, so fingertips turned under so you can't cut them. See? Works like a charm. Keep the thumb behind those fingers. There we go. Beautiful thin slices. Now, nice tiny little dice. If you're wondering what these are for, this is going to be for my Southwestern version with the pepper jack. Oh, it really is going to be a pepper jack now, isn't it? Now, what you just saw me do is in the knife world considered really dangerous, running your hand lengthwise on a blade. But if you'll notice what I did, I ran my hand lengthwise along the back of my blade. My finger was not in contact with this surface up here, and it's turned up. So I do it like that. So if you're not careful about it, you can hurt yourself. The best way is this way, or just knock it off, okay? Well, we now have our garlic and cheese ready for one dish, our jalapeno ready for another dish. All we need to do is make something festive looking for our third dish, right? Very nice, very thin little cut. Same cutting technique I just showed you. Get more of that red in there. There we go. Now, this mixture deserves to have some shallot, but I don't want solid rings. I want them kind of let them break apart. So I'm going to run my knife through there just to split it. How do you like that for some fancy cutting, huh? And that's not hard. Remember, the same shape. Fingers turned under, pinching that blade. All I'm doing is just making this motion and slowly bringing my fingers back like this so that the knife makes nice, beautiful, thin cuts. That's what's called slivering, okay? It gives you those super thin cuts. Now I'm going to mix all that together, and that, folks, is going to be used with some eggs. Now we have our vegetables processed. It's time just to move on to our next step here. Right, guys, take a look at this. We have our sausages right here, the chorizo sausage and also our pork sausage. Very much breakfast type sausage in the United States, very common. Now let's go ahead. I have two pans here. This one, I'm going to do my scramble in it. Come on out of there. There we go. This pan back here, I'm going to be doing my fried egg in. And it's kind of nice because the pan produces a very limited size egg, so it's not going to go anywhere past the perimeter of that pan. Another way to do it would be to use a small pan like this. Pretty similar. I could also fill this with butter, and think about this, guys. This is about teaching you these thoughts of creativity. If I wanted to do a really cool egg to go with those sausages, I could melt about, three, maybe four sticks of butter into this. And when it comes up to a good temperature, I can poach those eggs, poach them right in that butter, and then use that butter poached egg right there on top of my sandwich. Oh, yummy. Now, that's not what we're gonna be doing though. I'm gonna put some heat under these. Not too much. I want a medium-low heat under each one. Now the chorizo, it usually doesn't like to break down into little pieces the way ground beef would do if you were cooking it up. So what you want to do when it comes to that chorizo is be kind of patient with it. It's, like I said, it's difficult to break up. But once we do, we'll be adding it to our egg later after the egg is cooked. So I want this stuff pre-cooked. See how sticky it is? The meat fibers are quite loose in this. So just sort of spread it out the best you can. There we go. As you see, it wants to stick. That's sort of a normal behavior for a lot of different brands of chorizo. All right. Ick. Now, I'm not worried about crossing these back and forth because I'm just cooking both of them side by side. They're both pork products. Now, if this was a restaurant and I was cooking for, let's say, a vegetarian or for somebody of certain religious faiths, let's say a Muslim, that cannot have pork, it would be very, very, very wrong of me to then go ahead and start using these tongs to turn maybe some eggs that Muslim might be eating. I'm contaminating them. So don't do that. Be very careful and be very thoughtful about people's culinary needs if you are working on becoming a chef. Now, no seasoning is really needed on either of these. If you'll notice, I didn't put oil in either of the pans. I didn't put butter in there. They're both fatty products. You know, pork is fatty. So all I had to do is just put them in there to heat them up and get them cooked. You will notice that your chorizo will put out a lot of very yellow to orange colored oil, and that's that rendered fat. But the color comes from the chilies that they use in it to give it that, the color that it has, but the flavor that it has, the very strong, robust flavor. Let's take a good close look at that. See there? You can see that oil I'm talking about and how colorful it is. The butter I have here, and I'm going to use a stick right there. Butter is, even when it's room temperature, see, it's still a bit firm, okay? It's not going to spread too easy like this. So to make it spreadable, see, I'm using a fork. I'm just working it a bit. Once you work that butter for just a few minutes like this, it becomes very spreadable. And if you want it to become even softer and more velvety, add just a little bit of olive oil and work that in. There we go. Now, while that seems a little bit messy, I'll tell you what, it does make the butter much easier to work with. See how moist the chorizo remains? That is in its nature, in its character, so don't sweat that. And all we're doing is getting certain base ingredients ready to prepare our sandwiches. And sometimes you have to cook one thing in order to cook another. A good example is, you don't put raw hamburger on top of a pizza when you're cooking it. You first cook that hamburger, then you can put it on that pizza. But you don't want to put it up on there while it's still raw. If you'll notice how I scraped that thoroughly, that wasn't a mistake. It wasn't just to make noise. What that was to do was to get that fond off of the bottom. So when I cook my egg, the color of the egg won't be, well, it won't be turned orange. I'm cracking open one egg. Now, while there is some grease left in that pan from my sausage, I'm going to add just a little bit of peanut oil. I'm bringing that back up in temperature, and I have it over a medium heat right now. I'm going to gently scramble and then pour the egg right down into that pan. So So if you'll notice, I didn't really overwork that egg very much, did I? Not much at all. You see how he's forming up? Look at that beautiful, beautiful scramble, folks. That is gorgeous. Oops. Lost a few of my ingredients, but not much. If you're thinking, oh my, that looks really quite tasty, I agree with you. That looks delicious, doesn't it? And you're wondering, I thought I was going to watch a grilled cheese sandwich show. Guys, you are. You're watching one heck of a grilled cheese sandwich show. Add that chorizo back in there. And right before I make my sandwich, the chorizo gets mixed with the egg just very gently. Our butter. You remember we had garlic and Parmesan, and we need to prepare a butter spread. Now, all I'm trying to do is just get all of that cheese and garlic mixed in with the butter. I'm not being any too pretty about it, as you can see here. But as you can see, we're only using very basic ingredients too. Or basic utensils, I mean. A small bowl, a simple fork, and wham, looky there. Now, I have a beautiful garlic spread for the outside of some of my bread. Oh, one of those sandwiches is gonna be so tasty. Boom. It looks like those have done what they're supposed to do. I'm going to move this to my front burner. Did you notice how I moved that? When cast ironware is hot, guys, the handles get hot. So please be wary of that handle. Always assume those handles are hot for that stuff. I'm going to add a little bit of butter to this, which will give it a wonderful, rich flavor. I put some peanut oil in there just to increase the amount of liquid fat I have in the bottom, which makes cooking up an egg like this a lot easier. There we go. Crack him in there. Let him cook. All right, guys, now let's get on with getting these together. Cheeses are ready. All we have to do is butter up our bread. Now, I'm gonna start with this garlic butter. This is going to be, oh, that little wonderful Italian sandwich that we're going to make. So if you would, just keep buttering up all of that bread. Every single last bit of it has got to have your butter on it. Now you want each piece buttered on one side only. That's all that's needed. And I like to do it until I can see that the pores of the bread are filled. I don't want it to be too caked up on the surface, but I do want the pores filled. Now folks, you're probably noticing I'm using a different cutting board. Believe it or not, there is actually a purpose behind all of these different colors on cutting boards. The purpose there is that it tells you what that board was for. Now when it comes to whiteboard, you're dealing with bakery and dairy. So that's exactly what we're dealing with here, bakery and dairy goods. Bread, butter, eggs, it's all a whiteboard item. Now I do like getting it all the way to those edges because, you know, you get that butter soaking down into the edge of the bread and it really, really is a super good flavor. I think if you've ever had a grilled cheese sandwich, you know exactly what I'm talking about, where it gets kind of a medium brown to just before it turns black, a dark brown, and that flavor develops on it, and it's kind of salty. So I'll tell you what, if you would, keep doing yours the same exact way, and we'll meet on the other side when we get this done, okay? Hey guys, let's get on with cooking up this. I'm gonna turn on my burners, and I'm gonna start them on a high until I can get this to where it's starting to feel a little bit warm. And once it starts heating up, and I'm trying to heat these outer edges, that's the reason it's on high. And they're heating up first, sure enough. Ouch. Okay, see, that's under high heat, and I'm still able to touch that, which gives you some idea of how thick this thing is and how it holds heat. But still, it has hot spots like any pan of this type does. Now, when I'm cooking these things up, I actually want my temperature medium-low on my burners. And the reason I'm going for that temperature, I need to give my bread plenty of time to toast, to turn brown, and for that cheese to melt. Remember, we're doing two things at once. I have my prosciutto back here, and this is the bread with the garlic on it. Very simple. So I'm gonna put this guy right here. Beautiful. I want one slice of provolone on that side. I want one piece of the prosciutto, which is doubled over, and one slice of my mozzarella. There we go. I'm gonna put my other bread on top. So first sandwich is started. My next sandwich is gonna be that Southwestern sandwich. Oh, doesn't that sound good? We've got some Monterey Jack, and we have some chilies, green chilies. Oh yeah. Don't worry if some of those come out and hit that hot plate. That doesn't matter. Yes. I love those things. They are so tasty. Another piece of our cheese. And let's get the bread put together. Now remember, butter side up, butter side down on the heat. That's the part that toasts up for you. It's beautiful. Our next one. This one's going to be that huevos ranchero style. And it's going to have the Monterey Jack again. Boom. My eggs put right there on my sandwich. Oh, yeah. Yummy. Now, folks, we are redefining the grilled cheese sandwich right here and now. Boom. Hold it. Nope. Needs another slice of cheese. Grilled cheese is always best when there's two slices of cheese. And our last one, last but not least, it's wanting to mate. Whoops. I kind of got messed up, didn't it? Our American cheese. Yummy. Sausages. Our egg. The rest of our bread. There we go. Now the ugliest one of all, look at how that came out. It just kind of all broke up and kind of tore on us a little bit there, the bread did. This is gonna be the ugliest one of all, but sometimes, we're gonna see here, sometimes those things that look like they went horribly awry end up working out. So we shall see. Oh, beautiful. I turned this because I was starting to get browning more on one side than another. The same thing here. Remember, this is the one with the ruined bread, and look how it came out. Ruined my butt. This is just a prime example of you can't judge a book by its cover. All right, not when it comes to making grilled cheese sandwiches. So you see before you four beautiful sandwiches, a very elegant way of doing a simple sandwich. Grilled cheese, who would have thought? And what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna set these on what's called a pan rack. They work great as a cooling rack. You see right down here? Great way to cool those down. And the idea, I want to reduce the temperature on that sandwich before I cut it so that the cheese, the guts of it, doesn't go flowing out all over the place. There we have four beautiful, absolutely special sandwiches. Now, I'm gonna let the cheese spend about 2-3 minutes firming up, and then, folks, we're going to take these and slice them open. I'm gonna let you see the goodies we have inside. The first one, this guy. Looky there. That is our huevos rancheros. Wonderful little sandwich there, huh? Alrighty. Beautiful, isn't that? That's that Italian with the garlic on it. Oh, beautiful. Now, let's pull up another one. This one. Beautiful, look at that, guys. Yummy. Oh, wow. So, there we have that. And last, however, certainly not least, I want to make sure I get this the right way. Look at that. A beautiful egg running. Piece for me, running everywhere. Gorgeous, isn't it? Well, there you have it, guys. This over a little. Some beautiful, beautiful grilled cheese sandwiches. There we go, guys. Grilled cheese sandwiches. And a whole different way of seeing a grilled cheese sandwich. That's right. Grilled cheese sandwich doesn't have to be same old ever again. Not for you, not for anybody else. Oh, those jalapenos are so good. Delicious. Guys, this is incredible eating. There's no way I can eat all these. My neighbors, they love me when I do this stuff, okay? They absolutely love it. So they're gonna be eating well today, and I will too, and it's gonna be delicious. Guys, thank you very much for watching. If you have not done so, please subscribe, okay? Now, to my subscribers, I would like to say cheers. Thank you very much to you, and thanks for watching the show. Please share my shows with others, and folks, you have a good day. Goodbye.